Florence School of Regulation hosts today a workshop on geopolitics of energy transformation. And my partner here is Michael Bradshaw, professor of global energy at the Warwick Business School. Michael, you have looked with your colleagues on some scenarios. What do you expect in the next 10 years or in the next 15 years with this energy transition?
What we did, we explored four possible scenarios in terms of future pathways to 2030 initially, in terms of the different structures of global governance that might influence them. And the scenarios range from an outcome which was extremely positive in terms of multilateral cooperation, a world where we achieve the sustainable development goals and are well on the way to achieving our 2050 targets. But we also looked at other possible outcomes. One scenario which we call dirty nationalism is really a return to a world where states are competing with one another. They see a kind of zero-sum world where fossil fuels remain the dominant form of resource. Another scenario explored the possibility of a technology breakthrough, where in fact the world is divided between two rival camps, one around the United States and one around China, in a kind of clean tech and Cold War. And the final scenario, as ever, is called muddling through. It's really carrying on with what we've been doing. But the real issue is to understand that we can set targets, be it for 2030, 2050, but what we really need to focus is on the pathways and the forms of policy and governance, both in terms of national governments, regional agreements such as the European Union, but also the global architecture. You know, we have a current system based on the UNFCCC, 197 states. It's achieved a great deal, but actually carbon emissions continue to go up year on year. So one of the things we discussed was the possibility of an organization like G20 playing a bigger role, because G20 represents both the industrial economies and the emerging states. It's 19 countries plus the European Union. It's quite clear that organizations like the International Energy Agency, that they were designed to do a different job, and that was really around energy security of their member states, and that majority of future energy demand growth in the world is coming from the non-OECD. So scenarios are useful because they are looking at different architecture in terms of global governance, different outcomes, and emphasizing the focus on the pathways, how we can get from where we are to where we need to be. So I think that's a useful way of trying to flesh out what we need to do to get us on the right road to a positive outcome.
Yeah, as you also told in your presentation, this pathway to global carbon neutrality will bring also some losers.
Yes.
How serious these risks are, and could we mitigate these risks? And who are these losers?
Yeah, okay, I mean, as you yourself pointed out in your own summary of the IRENA report, one of the things that's different about this energy transition that we're on the way to is that it's what one might call a purposeful transition. The purpose is decarbonization, and we are bringing in, you know, sources of energy, but at the same time, it's putting a constraint on existing sources of energy. So in the past, when we had coal replaced by oil, coal still had a role because it generated electricity, and then we had other sources added to it, gas, nuclear, and so on, but the other fuels remained in the mix. The thing about this challenge is that we have to get rid of the fossil fuels, and therefore those economies, the so-called producer economies that make a living out of producing and selling fossil fuels, are likely to have a difficult future, because in the interim at least the price for their products may go down, and longer term we might see that we don't need what they produce anymore. So the fossil fuel economies and the companies that specialize in fossil fuel production are potential big losers. But there's also a major challenge there, in the sense that we need to come up with a way of managing that transition in a way that compensates those countries, those companies perhaps, but also people in communities that specialize in the production of fossil fuels. So we can't just demonize fossil fuels and turn our backs on them. We have to see dealing with this problem as part of the transition.
But Michael, if I see years ahead, do you really see some global tension growing because of the issue? Or you would say, well, you assume with your scientific background that, well, there will be ways how to smooth it out, or there will be actually rather good progress in the changing of energy sector?
It's difficult to say at the moment.
But what your personal view?
My own personal view is... I think it's going to be difficult. I think there are going to be some countries that embrace the challenge. We already, you know, for example, if you were to compare Saudi Arabia with Russia today, Saudi Arabia at least has the rhetoric, a 2030 vision, a diversification of the economy. And many of the Gulf fossil fuel producers have long had ambitions to diversify. So that the hope is that the rhetoric becomes a reality and that they do diversify and that therefore they are prepared for a world after oil. But you take the case of Russia. Russia is in a somewhat different position, although it's not a petrostate in the same way. Its government is highly dependent on revenues from oil and gas. It's producing lots of oil and gas today, but it's running out of cheaper oil. It's got plenty of gas. What it will run out of there is likely markets. But oil is the major source of revenue, and its future oil production in the late 2020s is going to be the Arctic and offshore, and that's very expensive. So I think there could be a problem for a country like Russia, which has failed to diversify, despite the rhetoric, in that it may find its major source of revenue starts to dry up, and it's not done a very good job of creating a more diversified and resilient economy. And so that may spell bad news, and it might, obviously, bad news for Russia, but bad news for its neighbors.
Well. Yeah. Well, thank you, Professor. Sure. It was very kind of you to agree to this interview.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.